And so on this first night of this stewardship, the spirituality of stewardship mission, we really focus on that first aspect of the threefold call of discipleship, and that is to deny yourself. And what exactly do we look at and reflect upon when we think of that simple phrase? When we look at within the stewardship way of life, one thing that we recognize is what the bishops of the United States clearly recognized when they wrote their document, Stewardship of Disciples Response, back in 1991. They started out by saying very simply that once one chooses to be a disciple, stewardship is not an option. And so the life of stewardship, the spirituality of stewardship, truly flows from that threefold call of discipleship. And as Ethan said, we'll be focusing on that first call step, and that is to deny yourself. A couple of Sundays ago, just before we started the season of Lent, we had a couple of passages in for the Sunday readings. And the first one came from the book of Leviticus, chapter 19, basically verses 1 and 2. And this is what God was saying to Moses. Speak to all the congregation of the people of Israel and say to them, you shall be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. You shall each revere your mother and father, and you shall keep my Sabbaths. I am the Lord your God. Do not turn to idols or make cast images for yourselves. I am the Lord your God. And from there, God goes on to describe to Moses what the many different commandments of the law are going to be, teaching Moses so that he could in turn teach the people of Israel what it meant to live that life of holiness. And when we follow through that passage, the holiness begins with truly seeking and understanding what the commandments of our Lord are for each one of us. Our holiness of life is all about seeking to obey those commandments and remain faithful to all of the teachings that Christ has handed down to us. And that's the first step in the spirituality of stewardship, to recognize that we are called to be holy. But then in the gospel for that same weekend, we hear this passage from the Gospel of Matthew. And Jesus says to the people, this is from chapter 5, verse 48. For if you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Do not even the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet only your brothers and sisters, what more are you doing than others? Do not even the Gentiles do the same? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. Jesus makes a new distinction between the life and call of holiness that we receive from God our Heavenly Father in the Old Testament to the new call of the life of perfection. And this passage comes in the midst of the Sermon on the Mount, when Jesus describes and teaches the people how they are to interact with one another, how they are to live out their lives as true disciples in communion with our Lord Jesus Christ and with one another. So the life of perfection then flows from how we seek to love God and to love our neighbor. The spirituality of stewardship speaks to the heart of these two things. And so let us take a look at a little bit of what it means to deny yourself. The stewardship way of life teaches us three things. First, that as disciples, we are called to give a grateful response. A grateful response to God, who has given us all things. If you stop and think about all of the things that we have in our world and in our lives, do we own any of it? In our human nature, we say, yes, we do. If we think about how we describe the possessions that we have in our lives, I'll go get my car. Let's go over to my house. I will see what I have to wear for the day. So we describe and talk in those terms as if we are the owners of all of these things. But when we look in our relationship with God, we can look to the words of Job. Naked I came into this world, and naked I shall go forth into the life to come. God has placed us as stewards over all of these things that we have in our lives. And so we begin by denying ourselves and placing the true ownership with God, our Heavenly Father. And when we're able to do that, we begin to develop and share in that grateful heart. If we think about when we go to, when our life here on earth is complete. Under my time and under Monsignor McGreen at St. Francis, every year I would listen to his homilies on stewardship, because in the month of November, we would have our annual stewardship renewal, a time to once again commit ourselves to that life of faithful stewardship. And you'll hear a couple of different lines over these 3 days that really stood out for me from those different homilies that he would give. I'm going to share the first one with you this evening as we begin to enter into this mission. Monsignor McGreed would every year would say to the people that in my years as a priest, I have done hundreds and hundreds of funerals, but I've yet to do a single funeral that had a U-Haul behind the hearse. In your case, you're wondering what a U-Haul is. That is a rental van, back that company, that rents trucks and different trailers to haul for people to haul their goods in and their possessions from one place to another. So in other words, Monsignor McGreed is simply saying he has never had a funeral that the person who had died is taking his possessions with them. We leave the world with nothing, just as we enter into this world. And so everything truly does belong to God. And we have to deny ourselves of that ownership and come to recognize that we are but mere stewards of all that God has given to us. I remember a wonderful joke that I heard many years ago that speaks to this as well. There was a particular gentleman, pretty well off, and he told his wife that when he died, he wanted to take all of his money with him. He wanted his wife to promise him that he would bury him with all of his money. And most of her friends and other neighbors and everything knew about this promise that she had to give to her husband as well. As the time came when he passed away, and after the funeral, people came up to the widow and started asking, "So, did you actually bury him with all of his money?" She's like, "Sure I did. I wrote him a check. If he can cash it, the money's all his." What we have in our life here on earth is given and provided to us by God, so that indeed we might use them for our needs here on earth. But God is the true owner of everything. And he invites us to see and recognize this clearly in our day-to-day lives and activities, to recognize that he is providing all of these things for us out of his love for each one of us. We can get caught up in the things that we have in this world. Think about how we often describe what we have. I love this. I love that. I would love to have this or love to have that. Thinking of the things that we want or have in our lives. But Jesus invites us to take a much different approach, to appreciate what we have as those true gifts. And by doing so, we can begin to develop that grateful heart that he invites us to have within our lives. Are we truly grateful for the things that we have in our lives? Not only the possessions, but more importantly, the people that Jesus surrounds us with throughout our lives here on earth, to lead us and to help us to understand more deeply that love that he has for each one of us. I'm one that takes great time whenever I am driving around to observe what is around me. I often find it interesting, I will pull up to a stoplight and kind of look at the people that are on either side of me and quickly begin to look at them and see them stuck either picking up their phone, checking their text messages, or talking on the phone, or simply looking directly ahead. They have that seemingly focus of, this is where I need to go, I'm not going to let anything at all distract me. I'm just the opposite. Everywhere that I go, whenever I'm driving, I'm constantly looking around, observing everything around me, whether it be road constructions that is going on to see what developments have been made, buildings that are going up to see how those projects are coming, or simply enjoying what God has created and surrounded me with. It was a great joy to be able to drive up to Banff on Saturday with Eden and Virginia to see the mountains up there and really just to be able to see the beauty of creation that God has created for us to enjoy. But I do that everywhere that I go. I've actually had the blessings of being able to drive through all 49 out of the 50 United States over my years. Wasn't something that I initially set out to do. But as the bishop sent me from Kansas to Winona, Minnesota for seminary, and then to Denver, Colorado, and then out to Emmitsburg, Maryland, the bishop put me on a good start to visiting a good number of states. And so I made it a point to go ahead and continue to see the rest of the United States and all the beauty that it was created. Another thing that is interesting back home in Kansas, being in the rural and agricultural areas that we are, if you're driving down the country roads, especially a dirt road, you better have one hand up on top of the steering wheel. Because as the other vehicle approaches, that person coming towards you is going to wave. And you better wave back. Because if it's somebody that you know, the next time they see you, they're going to say, "Why didn't you wave back to me?" We acknowledge the people as we're going around, recognizing that we are a family. And so this is what Jesus is inviting us to enter into in this life of stewardship, to truly recognize that everything we have is that gift that God has given to us. And it's up to us to see what we have in our lives and to see the blessings that we bestow upon us. Every year around Thanksgiving, it's amazing when they begin to start looking to Black Friday. I'm not sure if you have that up here in Canada, but Black Friday in the United States is the Friday after Thanksgiving. I once read and had it described very well. It's a day that people will go to great lengths to trample, to stomp, to make sure that they get the best deals for things that they don't need and things they will never use. They want to get those best deals, all thinking about the material possessions. When it comes to our life of faith and our stewardship way of life, we recognize that we are mere stewards, and the bumper sticker that was out a number of years ago does not apply to a faithful steward. The bumper sticker said that the one who with the most toys at the end wins. We take nothing with us. So how do we deny ourselves in our day-to-day lives, what is necessary for us to be able to do these things? The first thing is to develop that life of prayer, that true relationship with Christ our Savior. When we look at Christ, the life of Christ, we see him at several key moments in his life, in his ministry, leaving the disciples, going off by himself to spend time in prayer. The first time that we find him is, of course, as he begins his ministry. We are in this very season of Lent, seeking to model our lives in these days, after those 40 days that Jesus spent in the desert, praying and fasting. What was he doing in those days? Preparing himself to begin that public ministry, when he would go out and begin to preach and proclaim that the kingdom of God is at hand, to begin his public ministry. We do not know what his prayer time was like during those 40 days, but we know that it was fully uniting himself to God, his Heavenly Father, and the will of his Heavenly Father. For immediately afterwards, as he is tempted those three times, he has no difficulty at all in turning away the devil in those moments of temptation. And Jesus would go on several other times through his ministry. Here in a couple weeks, we will celebrate and recognize the second most significant moment when Jesus spent that time in prayer, and that is in the agony of the garden. He takes the three apostles with him and simply asks them a very simple favor: stay awake. Jesus goes into the garden, begins to pray by himself. And for that time, Jesus begins to pray so heavily and uniting himself so fully to the Father in such agony that he begins to sweat drops of blood. But when he goes back to the apostles, they are asleep. And each time he goes back, he asks them, could not you not stay awake with me for 1 hour? Do our lives become so busy that we are not able to stay awake with our Lord, that we can't take a few moments a day, each day, to really enter into that conversation with our Lord Jesus Christ? I think of prayer in this way. It is really a conversation with God. When I'm working with couples, preparing them for the sacrament of marriage, I'll oftentimes tell them that even after they are married, they still have to continue to date. Granted, they only date each other, but what is the dating experience all about for a young couple? When they're going out to eat, yes, they go out because they might be hungry, but that time that is spent at that time going out to eat is all about getting to know each other. Spending that time in conversation with each other so that they can get to know who they are, what they are about, whether or not that relationship is going to continue and develop, or if it's something that they can move on from. But the conversation is what's so important. But it's only in those moments of conversation that the two will really get to know who they are and what they are about. And this is the invitation that Jesus gives to each one of us, to be able to simply come and have a conversation with God, to quiet ourselves for a few moments so that we can talk to God and tell him about our day, about what's going on in our lives, our experiences, all things that we encounter, so that God in turn can offer himself back to us as well. And so what do we do for our time of prayer? Do we allow for that quiet time? There are many different formats and different styles and types of prayer, and we find one that is going to be most suitable to us. But whichever type of prayer truly enables us to enter into that conversation with Christ is what's going to be most effective in our lives. One of the things that people often can bring to me, they get discouraged in prayer because of all the distractions that come into their thoughts, into their minds while they are seeking to enter into that prayer. Couple ways to look at those distractions. First of all, what does God ask us to bring to him? We can simply say, well, it's our holiness, our goodness, all of that life of grace that we want to have within our lives. So we want to bring all that is good to our Lord Jesus. And that is well and true. But Jesus invites us to bring our entire lives to him in our time of prayer. Not just our prayer and our holiness, but everything that we are about and what we experience in our day-to-day lives. Many of those distractions that do come into our mind during that time of prayer are simply what we are about, things that we have coming up, things that we have to do, responsibilities, obligations that are necessary for us to fulfill. And so rather than seeing them as a distraction, recognize him as Jesus saying, come, allow me to be a part of those things as well. My life with you is not just for that hour on Sunday, but I want to be with you in all things and through all things. So we can simply put those into place and offer those up to the Lord into that time of prayer, asking our Savior to be with us through each of those different times and moments. But there's also those distractions that do come into our minds that we simply need to push aside. I'm one who enjoys the outdoors and likes to spend time both hunting and fishing and getting outdoor activities, including golf. And what happens when we're outside enjoying those things? We have those wonderful insects that for some reason Noah took onto the boat with him, so that we still have them, particularly the mosquitoes. That's one question that a lot of people want to ask God when they get to heaven. Why did you insist on Moses taking mosquitoes onto the boat with him? We could have done without them. Well, we have all of these flies and mosquitoes and other insects. And what do we do whenever they come around us? We start swatting them away, pushing them aside. And so that's a simple phrase that we can keep in mind for those other distractions that we don't need into our prayer life. Simply swat them away, push them aside. Because the more we try to think about them and force them out of our mind, the more they're going to stick in there. So we can simply say, swat them away with a simple phrase, Lord, remove them, so that I may enter more deeply into that conversation. Our time of prayer allows us to enter into that loving relationship with Christ so that we may experience more fully all that he has to offer to us. And so we have to begin developing that grateful heart, that grateful response of all that God, for all that God has given to us. When we see everything as a true blessing, that gratitude is going to grow all the more. When we look at the time that the Israelites spent in the desert, traveling from the slavery of Egypt into that promised land, what do we find them doing most often during that time? Complaining. They complain when they first lead him out. They see the Egyptians coming up behind them, and then immediately begin to complain to Moses. So is this what you've done? Let us out here in the desert to simply die at the hands of Pharaoh. God uses Moses to part the sea, takes him across, and they are no longer pursued by the Egyptians. But then the story and saga of the Israelites continues. They get out into the desert, and they become thirsty. And so they complain, have you let us out here into the desert to die of thirst? Would we were still back in Egypt when we had everything available to us? So God directs Moses to strike the rock at Meribah and provides them with all of the water that they needed. And then as time goes on, they begin to seemingly run out of food. And so they complain to Moses again. So now, have you left us out here to die with no meat to eat and no bread to provide for us? So again, God directs Moses to send them the quail and the manna in the desert. But they still never did come to understand. God did and provide for everything that they needed throughout that time that they spent in the desert. But we find them complaining more than they do of giving thanks to God. Even when Moses is up on the mountain for extended period, they quickly turn away from God and create the molten calf in which to worship, saying, this is what has been led you out of the desert. God provides all things. And when we look at our day-to-day lives, our day-to-day activities, how do our thoughts often sound? Are we complaining about this and that, concerned about one thing or another? Simply looking at what could have been or should have been or would have been if only we had done something different. Do we find ourselves with a complaining heart? Bishop Gerber, the Bishop Emeritus, who introduced the stewardship way of life to the entire diocese back in 1985, had a very simple saying regarding our gratitude. And the saying was simple as this: a grateful heart silences a complaining voice. A grateful heart silences a complaining voice. When we are filled with gratitude, it becomes very difficult for us to complain about the things around us. Think about the gifts that we exchange gifts. When somebody gives you a gift, the most appropriate response is thank you. Have you ever said thank you grudgingly to another who has given you something? Even if you didn't necessarily care for the gift, you still say that joyful, great thank you. And that is what Jesus is looking to us for as well. To have that grateful heart, recognizing that everything that we have, everything that is provided to us throughout our lives, comes directly from God. And we can only fully recognize this when we enter into that relationship with Christ, to deny ourselves and enter into that life of humility. What is the example that Christ set for us? At one point in his ministry, people came to him saying, "I will go and stay wherever you stay. I will follow wherever you lead." And Jesus' response, "I have no place. I have no home, but you're more than welcome to follow me." Jesus owned very little, if anything, throughout his life here on earth, setting that example for us that is what we are to follow as well. When Jesus sends the disciples out on their mission to preach and proclaim the good news of the kingdom of God, he tells them, "Take nothing with you, no money bag, no second tunic, no sandals," allowing them to recognize that God provides for all things as they pursue and go forth through their ministry. And so are we willing to enter into this true relationship with Christ our Savior? It is truly He who is going to provide all things for us through our lives here on earth. And so those two aspects, to deny ourselves, to seek to enter that true gratitude for God for all that He has given to us, really is that beginning in the life of holiness. Again, we look back to those two things that I began with. First of all, that call to be holy as God our Heavenly Father is holy. How do we look at the commandments that God has handed down to us? We can look at them as a negative. I shall not, you shall not, thinking of those first three words. But why does God give those commandments to the Israelites? And Jesus continued to expand on them with the precepts that we are called to follow. Jesus knows and fully understands our human nature. He knows what will lead us to a life of sorrow and despair, and what will lead us to a life of true peace and true joy. The commandments are handed down and given to us so that we can live those lives of holiness, avoiding those things which lead to sorrow and despair, and instead choosing those very things that would lead us to a greater peace and a greater joy in Christ our Savior. As members of that kingdom of God, we are to be those cheerful disciples, knowing that when we have chosen to follow that way of holiness, chosen to seek out that life of grace and goodness that Christ has placed before us, we will have that cheerful heart and a heart filled with gratitude. Our life of perfection in Christ our Savior is to fulfill that second command, to love God and to love our neighbor as ourself. Jesus places that command within our hearts because it is He who has first loved us in our lives. We can only do so when we are first grateful to Christ our Savior and seek to live with humility before our loving Savior and one another. When we seek to build ourselves up and to bring glory and honor to ourselves, we aren't going to find that true peace and joy. It is only in humbly serving Christ our Savior in the very manner that He came to serve each one of us, that we will come to understand that joy that He has promised to us. And so we are called and challenged each day to live as that faithful steward. Look to one other passage, and St. Paul writes in the letter to the Corinthians. And while these words primarily refer to the ministers of the early church, they apply to each one of us as well. Think of us in this way, as servants of Christ and stewards of God's mysteries. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be trustworthy. Stewards of the mysteries of God. What are those mysteries that we hold within our hearts? The first and greatest mystery is the depths of God's love for each one of us, of how much he has loved us to call us his children, to make us his disciples, to lead us through this journey of life out of his love for us, so that one day we may share in the fullness of his love in the life to come. It is from this mystery that all the other mysteries of our faith flow. The very gift of Christ, our Savior, from God, our Heavenly Father, flows out of this love that he has for us. It is his desire for us to first of all experience that desire in our own lives, so that in turn we may share it with one another. When I look back on my life, I see that I was blessed to be able to have that experience of God's love at an early age. As I was growing up, I would oftentimes be asked that question, "What do you want to do after high school?" It's a question that many such youth are asked throughout their years growing up. And as I was asked this time and again, many times I would respond with something that someone else had suggested to me. One of the first things, and I can remember going back to junior high, one of the first things that I thought about becoming was a pathologist. For those of you who don't know, a pathologist is one who takes care of the person after they have died. The only reason I can think of that I was thinking about becoming a pathologist is back in that time there was a television show on called Quincy Adams, MD. That was his role. He was the pathologist who solved crimes by taking care of the bodies after they had died. Today, it would be likened to Ducky on NCIS. The same role. It was something that I thought about for a little while. I also thought about doing something in landscaping. One of the first jobs that I had was simply mowing the neighbor's yards. So I enjoyed the outdoors, looking at different things like that. But then when I was in high school, the computer age was really starting to take off. So I took a computer class and thought about possibly doing that at the suggestion of somebody else. But each of these were something that came from the outside, things that others either suggested to me or thought about. But the first real recollection I have of what has led me to where I am today actually came back when I was in high school. Or actually when I was in grade school. I remember serving Mass one day, and after Mass, talking to the priest, telling him that I was going to be a priest when I grew up. The pastor of the parish that I was talking to at that time says, "Well, you know, it takes another 8 years of schooling after high school to become a priest." At that time, I thought, "I'll find something else." But then I thought about becoming a doctor or pathologist, which took even longer. The logic of a child does not always flow very well. But even in between each one of those different career paths that I thought about, the priesthood was always there, coming from within. It was always God's voice speaking to me in my heart, so that by the time I got to a senior in high school, I had pretty much made up my mind that I was going to enter the seminary. And here 20 plus years later, here I am serving as that priest of God. But that's what takes place when we quiet our voice and open up our voice to our Lord Jesus Christ. To truly deny ourselves, we can then see where God is leading us, what God is asking of us in our lives of faithful discipleship. Stewardship is that means through which we are able to live as that faithful disciple. And it all begins with that grateful response, a response of true gratitude for all that God has given to us and provided for us in our lives here on earth. We offer these final words tonight. Think about those words that are offered at every Mass in the words of the preface. It is truly right and just, always and everywhere, to give you thanks, Almighty God. Truly right and just, for it is from God that all things flow. It is God who provides all things for us. And so when we recognize that all things belong to God, we will know that it is truly right and just to give thanks to God always and everywhere. Let us take this time of adoration this evening to think about when we have encountered that true experience of God present to us and speaking to us in our hearts. It is from there that we will have a heart filled with gratitude and an even greater desire to serve Him in all things. Tomorrow evening we will look at the second aspect of that call of discipleship, to take up our cross, and in the stewardship way of life, to recognize and receive the gift that God has given to us. But again, it begins with that gratitude. Let us enter into that life of faith with Christ our Savior, that we will seek always and everywhere to give thanks to God our Heavenly Father.